Okay, thank you. And it's about continuous non-malleable codes in the split state model from minimal assumption. This is joint work with Rafi Ostrowski, Daniele Venturi, and Ivan Visconti. Okay, so we are talking about coding schemes. So there is some overlap with previous talks, so I'm going to go faster. So I have two algorithms. One is the encoding algorithm, the other is the decoding algorithm. The encoding algorithm can be randomized, so it takes a plain text, M, and outputs a code word, C. And the code word is given to the decoding algorithm, which comes up with a plain text. And hopefully, I want M to be equal to M prime. And I measure the efficiency as the rate, meaning the ratio between the length of the plain text and the length of the code word. And yeah, correctness, like if you encode M, then you decode, and you get the same thing with overwhelming probability over the random coin tosses of the encoding algorithm. The decoding algorithm could be, in principle, could be randomized as well, but typically it's deterministic. So there is a new notion on this that has been introduced quite recently, relatively recently, by Zembowski, Peterczak, and Vix, like a few years ago, and it's about non-malleable encodings. And so what do you have here? You have the encoding works as usual, but then before getting the code word to the decoding, there is an adversary that applies a function f, a tampering function, and this tampering function is independent of the randomness used by the encoding, and it creates a new code word, c tilde. And we want to prevent the adversary from creating a code word, c tilde, for a related plain text, m tilde. Non-malleable, so it means that either m tilde is equal to m, meaning f doesn't do anything, or that m tilde is independent of m, because the adversary can always just forget about c and encode a different message which is completely unrelated to m. And for example, you might have something like if the first bit of m tilde of m is zero, you leave it as it is. Otherwise, the adversary creates an invalid code word. That would be considered a success for the adversary. Or something else, like you take an encoding of m and you produce an encoding of m plus one. And of course, as has been pointed out also in the previous talk, like if you allow the adversary to do anything, then since this is a keyless primitive, then, okay, since it's a keyless primitive, it could just decode and re-encode a related message. So we are playing and we're trying to come up with a significant family of function, CalF, which is interesting enough and which we can do something meaningful with it. Okay, so this is the classical notion. And we look at the continuous non-malleability case. This has been introduced by Faust et al. A few years back. And the difference here now is that the adversary is not allowed just to try one tampering function, but it can try several tampering functions, polynomially many. Okay? So instead of having just f, you have fi for I equal 1 to poly. So there are some caveats. Okay, first of all, the same fi is applied to the, the fi's are applied to the same code word by the adversary. And we also have a restriction which is necessary that the first time the adversary produces an invalid code word, then the experiment stops. Meaning that from that moment on, the adversary just it doesn't get any feedback, essentially. It just says, oh, invalid, invalid, invalid. And also, in the adversary, in the experiment, when we have the experiment with two possible code words and two possible plaintexts, M0 and M1, and the adversary is trying to guess which one of the two has been encoded, of course we cannot, like if the adversary doesn't do anything, it cannot just learn, oh, that was an encoding of M0, so it just learns that that was an encoding of the same plaintext. So the definition, this is a game-based definition, like that the view of the adversary for any polynomial number of tampering queries is the same for any two plaintext M0 and M1. So there are various various applications of this concept. I'll be very, very fast. These are known and they have been discussed before. Essentially, they have to do with physical attacks, like we know that we can read some of the bits by reading the radiation. We can modify some of the bits. And some of these attacks are practical and effective on some important cryptographic primitives like AES. And so we want to protect against this. And in general, non-malleable codes could be used to do some sort of a compiler that makes things tamper-proof. Essentially, okay, so we compile the functionality that we are supposed to compute by taking the input and encoding the input and then operating on the code word. Okay, this is. And now, here, we are using, we let the adversary try several tampering functions with the exception that if at one point it produces an invalid code word, then all bets are off and the code word, the adversary gets no further information. And this is a theorem that was in the original paper that if is F non-malleable, meaning non-malleable with respect to a family of function, of tampering function, then the compiled functionality is F memory tampering, is secure against F memory tampering from the same family of functions. Okay, why continuous non-malleability? Essentially, continuous non-malleability from one-time non-malleability by at the price of re-encoding and perfectly erasing. Erasing could be problematic, as we know, that this is very hard to achieve in physics. And so what we do, we just try to encode this security notion in our primitive, and we try to construct it. Okay, this is an example that was also in the previous talk by Yanis. Non-malleability in general is impossible if we allow the adversary to do anything because it could decode, as I said before, it's a keyless primitive, and you know, read, oh, this is M, and now I encode M plus one, and then I win the game. In this talk, I concentrate on a specific model, which is the split state model. In the split state model, the code word is divided into left and right part, and the adversary can tamper each of the two parts independently. So it has two tampering functions, F0 for the left part and F1 for the right part, and each is applied to the left part and the right part. Okay, so let's now talk a little bit about our definition. First of all, I imposed a self-destruct condition, like the first time the adversary produces an invalid code word, then the whole system destructs. Why is this necessary? This is necessary for otherwise we cannot achieve any security. And there is a very simple attack which is described on this talk. Like the adversary makes one tampering query for each bit of the code word. And he manages to reconstruct the whole code word. And once he has the whole code word, then he can do anything because he can decode it locally and then have two tampering functions that just encode a related message. Okay, so how is the attack? He makes one tampering query for each bit of the code word. So he keeps a current reading of the bits of the code words, xi to x in minus one. And then he does the following. The tampering, the ith tampering, just sets the ith bit of the code word to zero. And then it sees what happens. If it gets, it can only get two possible results, same or spade or error. If it gets same, then it guesses that the code word has encrypted, the ith bit of the code word is zero, otherwise he deduces that it's one. And then he constructs. It doesn't actually, if you think carefully, it doesn't actually reconstruct the same code word, but it reconstructs a code word that decodes correctly to the same message that was encoded. And once he has X, the old code word, then he can do the attack. So unless we prevent the adversary from to mount this attack, there is no possible possibility of achieving non-malleability. So let's talk now about a necessary condition, another necessary condition. So this was observed in the first paper that dealt with continuous non-malleable codes, and that any continuously non-malleable code that is secure needs to enjoy the following message uniqueness property. Essentially means that for any left part C0 prime, there must be only one possible right part that make a legal code word. And if this is not true, then you could have a simple attack that defeats continuous non-malleability. And So this is the attack. Essentially, the attack is the following, like the two tampering functions, F0 and F1, what do? They just rewrite the left part with C0 prime, and then they rewrite the right part with C0 1 prime or C0 double prime, C1 prime or C1 double prime, depending on the ith bit. And then the decode, and then it sees, observes whether, oh, do I get M prime or M double prime, and then I read the specific bit. And this attack will work unless the message is unique. Because if the, unless the code has the message uniqueness property, because in that case you cannot, either you cause an error, in which case you lose, the adversary loses, or you just can, you just know what happens. You get the same message. So there has been some previous work on non-malleable code. One time non-malleable code, they were introduced by Zembowski et al. In 2010. And a state-of-the-art construction is by Agavar et al. That gave first information theoretic in the plane model, multiple bits, stock some few years back. And there is also another construction that added the leakage resiliency. And for continuous non-malleable, that was introduced by Faust, and they only had a construction with strong setup assumptions. Also, as I said, there is one important distinction between persistent and non-persistent. If you remind when I said, when I explained the model, in persistent, we are in the persistent case, like the code word says the same and the same function is the tampering functions are applied on the same code word. This is without loss of generality because you can think that if you want a non-persistent, like you apply F1 and then you have a new code word, and then you apply F2 on the second code word, this is you can always do this in the persistent case because what do? Oh, okay, you just, instead of having F2, you have F1 composed with F2. And there is another notion between basic non-malleability and super non-malleability, which depends on whether the adversary sees the decoded message or the tampered code word. And this has an important consequence on the achievability of the notion because Faust et al. Considered super non-malleability, which implies code word uniqueness, and had their construction in the CRS model. And recently, there has been a paper by Dachman, Soled, and Kulkarni that proved that code word uniqueness implies supernormality for the split state, and this requires non-falsifiable assumptions. So what do? We go back to the standard normality of the original paper by Zembowski et al, and this is what we do. We prove that if one-to-one one-way functions exist, then there exists continuous normalizable code in the split state model in the standard model, like no CRS. And of course, no non-falsifiable assumption. And we also prove that there is a message unicode, like a code that has the property of message uniqueness, but that is not continuous normalizable. In fact, for a while during our research, we thought that uniqueness was not only necessary, but was also sufficient, but we have a very simple construction. So now I'll give you an overview, a very fast overview of what we do and how we do it. This is a first attempt. Okay, so we know that we need uniqueness. How do you impose uniqueness? You do a commitment. So what do? You do a commitment gamma zero, gamma one of M, and then you, on the left part, you put one of the commitment and the randomness used for the other, and vice versa. So you have gamma zero R1, gamma one R0 on the left right part. The problem is that commitments now could reveal, commitments are not supposed to reveal the message, but they might reveal a bit. You know, you might have a stupid commitment that has, that doesn't use one of the random bits and then repeats the random bits in the commitment without affecting property. And this is a problem because now, if you try to prove security of the non-malleability of this construction, even if you use non-interactive non-malleable commitment, which you can do under some very strong assumption, then it's very difficult to reduce the attack to an attack on non-malleable commitment. And here I have on the slides an explanation of this, but I'm going to skip. So what do, essentially? We hide the randomness of a commitment by encoding the message. We now a non-interactive commitment, which quite surprising could be a regular non-interactive commitment. It doesn't need to be non-malleable. And then we use an inner non-malleable encoding to encode the message and the randomness. So this is our construction. So you have a left part, which is a commitment gamma of the plaintext M using randomness R. And then you have C0 prime, which is the left part of a non-malleable commitment, one-time non-malleable commitment, of M concatenated with R. So how do you decode? When you get C0 and C1, you first check that the same commitment gamma appears left and right. And if it's the case, then you decode C0 prime, C1 prime to get M and R. And then you check that M and R are actually the plaintext, the message, and the randomness used to compute gamma. And if this is the case, you give M as an output. So this is the main this is the construction. And there are some, okay, how do you do this? Now, you're going to reduce an attack on this, on an attack on either on the commitment or on the inner one-time code. The inner one-time code is information theoretical. This gives us some leverage because now our reduction can run in exponential time. And this is important because we're going to use our exponential time to break the commitment. Okay, the commitment is a statistically binding, so I can break it in if I have enough time, and I still have a significant, I still have a meaningful reduction because the inner construction, the inner one-time code, is information theoretically. But to do so, I have a problem because the inner code knows nothing about commitment, but I'm using commitment, so I need a function that leaks some information, that says, oh, suppose that there is a commitment, then what do I do? I apply the commitment and I want to know what happens. And then I need to equip our inner one-time non-malleable code with the leakage function. And this is what, and this has been achieved for one time in a paper by Agavar et al, which we are going to use internally. Okay, so this is the proof, an overview of proof, which I'm going to skip since I'm running out of time. And this is the main trick. The main trick is that, okay, so we also have one more restriction. The inner code is a one-time code, okay? So I cannot ask many questions. Actually, I can only ask one question. So what do? I do the following. I just simulate optimistically, meaning that every time I receive a query from my continuous attacker, I just enumerate all possible commitments, and then I reply to the attacker with the answer which has the highest probability. And then I continue. When the attacker at the end knows, you know, feels that he can break it, what do? I do a leakage query. A leakage query that says, oh, tell me, of all these queries that I have simulated optimistically internally, what was the first query that actually had, you know, I made a mistake, so that I can rewind there and start the simulation again. That's that. And now, of course, you have to think that, oh, okay, leakage is, oh, I have leakage, but I don't have unbounded leakage, okay? So I have to bound the number of mistakes that I make, and to bound the number of mistakes that I make, I need code word independence, a conditional independence, meaning that essentially there is no subliminal channel between the left and the right part. And these properties that we formalize as code word independence and conditional independence, we formalize and we show that they are sufficient, so we can do our proof. And then we use the Agavar et al. From TCC16 construction and prove that, okay, it's information information theoretically secure even in the presence of leakage. This was known, and what we do, we prove this two specific technical property that we need for our proof to go through. Oh, and this is the second result. I just have one slide on this. Its uniqueness is not sufficient. This is a unique code, which is, okay, this escaped us for a while, so we thought we deserved a slide, and it can be broken without two tampering queries. And I'm running out of time, so I'll do very quickly. Essentially, what does it do? It does the following. You have you have one-time path, M plus K. M is the message, K is the key of the one-time path. And what do? You do the following. You decode, you non-malleably encode both M and K. But then the decoding is very stupid because it only looks at C00, C01, and then that's what it does. And now what do? I can switch the two C00 with C01 and C01 and C11 so that I learn K, and then I use K to decode from the one-time path. Essentially, that's. And once I have M, I can do whatever because then I can encode. So with two tampering queries, first swap and learn K, and then actually do the attack, I can break, and this scheme is easily seen to be message unique. Okay, thank you. That's what I wanted to say. Sorry, I was a little bit out of time.